The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe at 2:15. Now, Rudolf Nureyev presents The Dance Goes On.
I'm Rudolf Nureyev, and my life is devoted to dance. And when I look at paintings representing a dance, I'm often very critical. Many are pretty pictures, but they do not capture the joy of the dancer's art. But not this painting. It expresses the essence of ballet. Only an artist who knows what it means to be a dancer could produce picture of this quality, and the artist who painted this picture certainly knows about the ballet. Like me, she was a dancer, but the fate dealt her the cruelest of blows. The story I'm going to tell you, the story behind this painting, is one of the most extraordinary stories in the world of modern dance.
Thank you. All right.
I had that nightmare again. I was dancing through the streets.
But for Elizabeth Twistington Higgins, it was her waking hours which were the nightmare. Elizabeth was born into a medical family. Her father was a distinguished surgeon who met her mother during the First World War, when she was a nursing sister in France. They were to have 6 children, most of whom followed in their parents' footsteps. But not Elizabeth. At the age of 14, she was taken to see Little Feats at Sadler's Wells Theatre in London. From that magical moment on, she was determined to become a ballet dancer. It wasn't easy for her. She should have started training much earlier. Physically, she was too tall and too plump, and her doubting parents needed to be convinced that the stage was a suitable career for her. But Elizabeth was under the spell of the dance and overcame all obstacles, eventually winning the internationally prized solo seal of the Royal Academy of Dancing. Soon afterwards, she became a member of Corps de Ballet in the Soul of Norway in the West End of London. Later, Elizabeth danced in films and on television and appeared at the London Palladium. She successfully auditioned for Ivor Novello's King's Rhapsody at the Palace Theatre, but although she was appearing in 8 performances a week, her life seemed unfulfilled, so she made time to teach others the arts of dancing. At first, she became a visiting teacher to a school for delicate children, where the exercises strengthened their lungs and bodies. At the Coram Fields Play Center, she performed in special Saturday concerts, where children were admitted for a penny, thus earning the nickname of the Penny Ballerina. After she had been dancing on the West End stage for 6 years, Elizabeth began her own dancing school in Queen Square, opposite the famous National Hospital for Nervous Diseases. On a hot summer day in 1953, she was about to take one of her regular classes when she began to feel feverish. It was the prelude to an illness which shattered her career. 2 days later, she was rushed from her parents' home to the National Hospital in Queen Square. Ironically, on the opposite side of the square, some of her pupils were waiting for a lesson from her, not knowing that the speeding ambulance carried their Penny Ballerina. Elizabeth had been stricken by polio. It paralyzed her entire body from the neck down. Not only would she never be able to move again, but she had also lost the ability even to breathe. Mercifully, she was too ill to realize, as she was lifted from the trolley, that for the rest of her life she would be dependent upon an iron lung. Her world was now reduced to the view in a mirror. One of the people she saw in it was Sheridan Russell, the hospital almoner and a brilliant cellist. Often he lightened her day with a private recital.
One morning, one of the doctors, one of the registrars, came to see me and said, I've been fighting for her life for 1 day and 2 nights, and I'm absolutely exhausted, but she's done it, she's alive. So I just looked at him and said, was it the right thing to do? And he said, oh, it's not for me to decide, is it? I must say, at the time, I felt that it was a pity because her future seemed very, very bleak. But of course, when she started getting out, when she started doing things, then I realized, well, probably it was worth it. And I must say, when one thinks of what she's done, I realize it was worth it.
New Zealand author Marc Alexander, Elizabeth's biographer, recalls her plight vividly.
When I arrived in England from New Zealand, it was here in Queen Square that I became a nursing orderly at the National Hospital. I found it a most enriching experience, but of all the patients I helped, I've never been able to forget the paralyzed ballet dancer. Her tragedy seems so emphasized by the fact that her whole career had been one of movement. And it was hard to hide my feelings when I helped to lift her in and out of her iron lung. She was taught to force air into her lungs by developing a small neck muscle. You and I breathe automatically, but Elizabeth had to learn to breathe consciously. Every breath she takes is a deliberate, conscious act. I remember how we used to lift her out and time her with a stopwatch. It took 3 months of agonized determination before she could survive on her own for 90 seconds. After 7 months, she was able to manage a quarter of an hour, but this was only the beginning.
There lay hidden an extraordinary talent Elizabeth never knew she possessed, which freed her from institutional life. After 12 years and as many hospitals, today this house in Chelmsford, Essex, is her home. But she has to return to a hospital, Iron Lung, each night to sleep. At Broomfield Hospital, Elizabeth begins the 2-hour ritual of being prepared for the day. Still as physically dependent as ever on her nurses and helpers, she has never allowed her mind to vegetate and has retained full control of her life.
Why my hair?
She's landed.
Oh, dear.
For Karen Perry, a young dancer, getting up in the morning is as easy as overcoming the temptation to stay in a warm bed.
Can go gently on that side.
Yes, I can. I'm going to take the petunias out, I think, first, because I think they've had it now.
Rosie, you can't. I can barely take a flower away before it's finished its life.
Are you ready?
No, I'm not.
How about that maths, Rachel, you were busy with last night? Did you finish
it? Morning.
Hope you're late.
Can you work?
I'm getting on anyway.
Does your teacher assist? Yeah.
Karen, what time is your lesson today?
What's your name?
I'm going to have to get a move on, aren't you?
So we mustn't be long either, because we keep missing the bus. It comes earlier and earlier every day. We have to walk up.
Years ago, it seemed that Elizabeth's career had ended forever. The heartbreaking discipline of bad.